helping to get our hearts and minds prepared for worship. Good morning. It's good to see each of you here on this joyous day as we come to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, as we come to participate in the ministry of deacons here at First Baptist Church through ordination, installation, and commissioning of our deacons and the good work that they do. So it's going to be a great day of celebration, a great day of worship, and I'm so glad that you're here with us to spend this time. If you're a guest with us, we are especially glad to have you. Maybe you're a guest here with family. Maybe you are visiting our church, looking for a church that you want to worship at. Either way, we are so glad that you are here. We want to ask everybody to please remove the Connect card from their order of worship. Hopefully a little bit neater than I just did this one. But if you'll please do that, and if you are a regular worshiper with us, we just need your name. It really helps us if you do that. If you're a guest with us, we'd love to get a little bit more information from you. But whatever you're willing to share with us, a phone number, an address, an email address, some way we can communicate to you, answer any questions you might have about our church, or at least just say thank you for worshiping with us today. On the other side of that are some sign-ups. The first is the Prepare Hymn Room. This is a new Advent and Christmas event that we're doing this year, specifically for women. And that's going to be from 4 to 6:30 on Saturday, December the 16th. It's going to be a simulcast event, a great time of worship and study and focus on Jesus to really get your hearts ready to celebrate Christmas the right way. And so that will be here in the sanctuary. It's free, so ladies, come. Invite your friends to come. If you've got a friend that maybe doesn't go to church, doesn't know the Lord, it'll be a great event to bring them to help them understand the true story of Christmas. There will be food in the atrium, so there will be some appetizers to enjoy, and then the time together in the Word will be in here. So please sign up for that. Spread the word about that. You'll also see drive-through nativity help. We did construction yesterday, and that's a big part of drive-through nativity. But we've also got the actual event, and that's a big thing too. And we got to have people helping with a lot of different things to make this happen. And so if you can help, if you can pray, if you can act, if you can continue to help us with sets, there's still work to be done, decorating to be done, that sort of thing. Food, traffic, parking, costumes, lots of stuff that you can still sign up and be a part of, either leading up to it or the week of, maybe one, two, or all 3 days. I know specifically we are short on Mary Joseph, people who can play the role of Mary and Joseph. So if that's something you could do, because Mary and Joseph show up in a lot of scenes, imagine that. We need a lot of Marys and Josephs. So if you can do that, please put on there, you know, M and J or, you know, whatever, so you can let us know. Men, Joseph, women, Mary. We try to keep it that way. But the other thing is not on here, but it was in your Sunday school folders. We're going to be having a Lottie Moon dessert auction coming up a week from Wednesday, not this Wednesday, but the next, and we'll see our tiny kids do their nativity. So if you want to bring a dessert for the dessert auction, and every penny goes to Lottie Moon, just put down here on this piece of paper, dessert, and we'll know that you're planning on bringing something for the dessert auction. That'd be very helpful. When you're finished with this, fold it in half, and you can drop it in the offering box as you leave, or just leave it there in your pew, and we'll pick that up. If you'll look inside your order of worship, a couple other things I want to point out. One, on the left side there, church ornaments. Today's the last day if you want to purchase a church ornament. It's going to be our stained glass window. It's going to be beautiful. And so if you want to have one of those, please go to the atrium immediately following the worship service, and you can purchase that there. They also have prints as well. You can get a larger print of it. And that'd be a great gift for you to share with people this Christmas. And you'll see the foster care angel tree. Is also available in the atrium. You can pick one of the foster care children that our local DFACS helps to serve, and you can help make sure they have a good Christmas. And so if you as a family or a Sunday school class want to go in together and do that, that'd be great. And those gifts are due back on Sunday, December the 3rd. Also make notice that tonight at 5 is our budget presentation with supper, so I hope you'll come. It's more than just presenting next year's budget. We're going to celebrate what God has been doing this year. We're going to look forward with some vision of what God wants to do in our church next year. So it'll be a great time of fellowship and celebration and learning some really good things to share with each other, as well as looking at next year's budget, which we will vote on next Sunday morning at the end of worship. And following that, for families, there's going to be a movie shown outside on the back side of the warehouse, and so families can stay and enjoy that Christmas movie together out there. Notice that Thanksgiving's coming up this week, if you didn't know. Coming up this week, and church offices will be closed. But on Friday, we're going to be decorating the sanctuary and the church for Christmas. Again, that's something you could help come be a part of. On Saturday night, we've got a concert, Mark Trammell and the Wisnets, followed on Sunday night by the Community Chorus. We'll be bringing their Christmas concert as well at 5 o'clock here. Both of those are here in the sanctuary. We don't have much going on, but what we do, I hope you'll come be a part of. Amen. All right. As we begin this time of worship today, and we're going to be celebrating deacons and focusing on deacons today and talking about service and the grace to serve that God gives us. But we have some people that serve us on a regular basis here, members of our staff that just go above and beyond the call of duty. They work hard and they help to make sure that things are happening, that buildings are working correctly, things are cleaned and fixed. That everything's ready for us every Sunday morning that we come into worship. Every Wednesday night we come in to eat and to study God's Word together. They are working hard, making sure we've got bulletins and worship kits and all these things. So much that we just can tend to take for granted. But I am so grateful for these staff members. And three in particular that I want us to recognize today because of their years of service. And the first is going to be David Harbison. Mr. David Harbison, would you please come up? David has been our chief of operations here at the church, overseeing our custodial staff and making sure our building is in functioning shape week in and week out, and he has now been with us for 10 years. So we're thankful for Mr. David Harbison. Congratulations. Part of his staff is Mr. Billy Haddon. Billy, he's our weekend custodian. He comes on Wednesday nights and he comes on Sundays and helps to open up and lock up and turn on heat and air conditioners and turn off lights and unlock and lock doors. He does a lot to help make sure that this place is ready for us week in and week out. Helps make sure that our baptistry water is nice and toasty when we get in there on baptisms. Mr. Billy has been with us now for 20 years. Thank you, Billy. And last but not least is Mr. Kathy Hendricks, who I have to apologize. We missed her last year. Last year was her 10-year anniversary. So we threw a little extra something in there to make up for the year we missed Kathy. I apologize for that. We are so thankful for them, for their dedication, for their hard work, and just a lot of things that you don't necessarily see, but it's so important, behind-the-scenes stuff, that without them, trust me, you'd notice it. So again, thank you guys so much. We love y'all. We're thankful for you. As we begin this time of worship, I want to invite you to go to the Lord with me in prayer. Father, we are so thankful for David, for Billy, for Kathy, Lord, for all of the wonderful staff you have blessed us with here, Father, for all the work they do all week long to help us to love you, to love one another, and to make disciples for Jesus from all generations. God, we are just so thankful for them and for you bringing them to us and keeping them here with us, and we pray for many more years a faithful service, Lord, that you would bless them and encourage them and meet their needs. And God, we're thankful that we can come together in worship to glorify the name of Jesus, to open our hearts to hear what you would have to say to us from your word. And we pray, God, that you would be blessed and glorified in all that we do. We thank you, Lord, for our deacons. We thank you for these three new men, Lord, that you have called into this ministry that we'll be ordaining today. And we're thankful for all of their families and the support that they give to the vital ministry of deacons here at First Baptist Church. And we thank the Lord for our tiny kid and our team kid choirs and their leaders. And as they come to lead us in worship, God, we pray you'd continue to prepare our hearts and minds to hear what you would have to say to us. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said,
Friends, I hope that did for you what it did for me, which is to let me know very clearly how much I have to be thankful for. And I'm so thankful not just for these kids, but I'm so thankful for getting to hear them praise the Lord our God. And that's what we're going to do. We're going to do it with a smile on our face, with joy in our heart, because this is a good day to be thankful. Let's stand together and let's sing together.
To God be the glory, great things He have done. So loved He the world that He gave us His Son, who yielded His life at the atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord.
Standing as Jay and Cleve come and read God's word for us.
Our Old Testament reading is Isaiah 40, verses 8 through 10. But you, O Israel, my servant, Jacob, whom I have chosen, you descendants of Abraham, my friend, I took you from the ends of the earth, from its farthest corners, and I called you. I said, you are my servant. I have chosen you and have not rejected you. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous hand.
Our New Testament reading is John 13, 12 through 17 and 34 through 35. When he finished washing their feet, he put his clothes and returned to his place. Do you understand what I have done for you? He asked them. You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash others' feet. I've set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. I tell you the truth, no servant is greater than his master, nor a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. Verse 34, a new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Let's remain standing just a little while longer. Put ourselves in the place of these servants and these workers as we sing together. So much to rejoice in, but so much to commit to God as well.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trial, trumpet calls, so lift your voice. It's a year of Jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes.
Let's sing one more verse together.
These are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding the temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest, the fields are as white in the world. And we are your laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, so lift your voice. It's a year of Jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes.
Amen. I sure hope there's some smiles in some people's faces today. It is a good day to be in the house of the Lord. You are invited to have a seat. We're going to turn our attention more and more to this charge, not just to the deacons, but to our entire church, that we are all to serve the Lord with gladness, that we are all to be God's hands and feet in the world. It's a very high calling. We are called to be worthy of it. So let's take that seriously.
Worthy are.
Boys and girls, if you will come on down. Good to see you all. We'll scoot over. All right. And I know we have a bunch of them here. I just heard your all's beautiful voices up here. So thank you all for leading us in worship today. All right. It's good to see you all. I know we have a few more coming down. So today is going to be a little bit different. I have a guest down here that a lot of you all know, Mr. J, right? Mr. J, yes. We all love Mr. J. And, you know, Mr. J is like a rock star to these kids. He really is. And I'm thankful for him. And thinking of Thanksgiving coming up, I'm thankful for people that serve and help. And not only as a pastor here, but as a parent. I have three children in the children's ministry. And Mr. J helps in many ways with our children and youth. But I wanted him to share a few words just on his heart, what it means as a man of this church to work with children. So I'm going to switch this over to Mr. J.
Should be good. All right. Good morning, boys and girls. How y'all doing? Good, good. Isn't this a blessing, ladies and gentlemen? Isn't this a blessing? I just want to reach out to each and every parent here today, grandparent, aunt, uncle, guardian. Thank you so much for getting these children up in the morning and getting them to Sunday school and church. Thank you very much. Thank you. We had to get two ready. We're old. We know what it's like. We have a great fifth level with Candy Bags in charge up there. She and I teach first and second grade. Kelly Kitchens and April Matthews do third and fourth. And Frank Wills and Shelley Ward do the fifth and sixth. And we are so excited to have them up there on the fifth level. But we don't want it to be a monopoly. We don't want to be the only ones up there on the fifth level. So if at any time you feel led to come and join us, please, there is room for you up on the fifth level. We don't always have to teach every Sunday morning. We would be glad to sit back and let someone else take the reins. It's very important for especially the younger generation to step up. Unfortunately, I have to admit, maybe for not all of them up there on the fifth level, but most of us are of the older generation. We want to keep the blood alive, just like with this great group we've got down here. It's such an honor to be up there with your children, to give us the responsibility of shepherding them and teaching them and instructing them and disciplining them. Thank you very much for those kind words that you tell us. Do what you need to do to keep my child in line. That's very important. We love these kids and we only want the best for them. We want what God wants for them, and that is to be brought up in a loving Christian environment. And that's what we strive to do. And I enjoy being up there, but like I said, I would gladly take a back seat to anyone. And guys, I'm kind of especially pointing to you, because it is important when you've got a 10 first and second graders all in one room. It can get kind of busy at times. To put it mildly. So, especially to the guys out there, if you ever feel led to come and join us on the fifth level, I will gladly take a back seat. Any of us would be glad to take a back seat. So, with that being said, boys and girls, I love each and every one of you. I love working with you on Sunday mornings and our field trips that we take. Sometimes I take...
Field trips?
Yes, we... well,
field
We'll eventually go on a field trip. We'll eventually go somewhere, and we like to go bowling. We like to go. We went to Columbia to the museum one time, the Children's Museum in Columbia. So, with that being said, boys and girls, look at me. Look at me. Eyes on me. Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning, okay? Eyes closed, heads bowed. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for these young children that are part of this church. It is so vital that we have this young blood in our church. And we thank you for the parents and the grandparents and the guardians that get them up in the mornings and get them here for Sunday school and church. We thank you for that wonderful blessing. Dear Lord, I've been with this church most of my life, and I love this church, and I love what God is doing in this church. Thank you, dear Lord, for every good thing you've done for First Baptist Church. Amen.
All right.
Thank you, boys and girls. Thank you, Mr. J. We appreciate you so much. At this time, children can go to Children's Church, and our twos and threes, that'll be in the nursery area, and then K4 and K5, that'll be in the chapel building. I know we have some guests today. If you need to know where your child is going, please see me at the end, and I can help direct you that way to find them.
Amen.
So one Sunday morning, there was a mom who was making pancakes for her two rambunctious sons, and they began to fight over who would get to eat the first pancake. And so the mom saw this as a teachable moment. And she said, "Now, boys, don't argue. If Jesus were here, he'd say, 'Let my brother eat the first pancake.'" And she was impressed when she saw her oldest son's eyes grow large with understanding as he said to his younger brother, "Okay, you be Jesus." You don't have to teach children to be selfish, do you? From an early age, we master the art of looking out for number one. Thinking of others and being kind and helpful, these are things that can take a lifetime for us to master. And if we're honest this morning, we'll recognize our own innate tendencies to drift toward self-centeredness, to drift toward an inward focus. And that's true for us as individuals and families and even as churches. That inward drift is something that we always have to resist. You know, like you're swimming against the current. We have to constantly fight that tendency. Several weeks ago in the I Am series, we talked about how Jesus said, "I am the vine and you are the branches." And that what he meant is that we have to stay connected with him. We have to remain in him if we want his life and his love to flow through us so that we can serve others and help others and share the gospel with others. We do that as Jesus works through us. We are channels of God's blessings. And that means that the gifts that we give, the talents that we have to serve, it means the gospel that we share, ultimately all come from him, not from us. We are vessels through whom God speaks and works in the world. And so that means that whenever God speaks to you, it always comes with the expectation that you're going to share his truth with other people. When God forgives you, it comes with the expectation that you are going to forgive other people. When God blesses you, he expects you to pass that blessing on to other people. When God comforts you, he wants you then to turn around and comfort someone else. And that brings us to Paul's words in Galatians chapter 5, verses 13 and 14. It's just two verses. They'll be up there on the screen for you. Galatians 5, 13 and 14, Paul says, "For you were called to be free, brothers and sisters. Only don't use this freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but serve one another through love. For the whole law is fulfilled in one statement, love your neighbor as yourself." Notice here Paul says that even God's grace, even the forgiveness of sins, eternal life, the spiritual freedom we enjoy can go to our heads can swell our egos, can rob us of the very things they were meant to give us, love, joy, peace, the fruit of the Spirit. We can even take these good gifts of God and twist them for selfish purposes. And that's why Paul warns us not to use God's freedom and grace for self-indulgence, not to let that become an inward focus for us. And he tells us the antidote to this problem is serving others. Service is a gift of grace because it helps us to keep an outward focus. It helps us to look up to God in gratitude for all of His generosity toward us and to look to those around us as people whom we can serve in Jesus' name. Both statistics and Scripture tell us that healthy, growing churches are outwardly focused churches. They're churches that are missional. They're evangelistic. They're concerned with reaching out and blessing the community around them. And if that's true of healthy, growing churches, then that's also true of healthy, growing Christians. Amen? When I think of our church, I see a lot of outwardly focused ministry. Operation Christmas Child, we're collecting this week, or have been collecting all this week from all the churches and organizations around us, and we're going to forward all those boxes on. And we've got a lot of boxes that we've collected, but I'm super excited by the fact that between the Christmas in July focus we did in July and the boxes that have come in this month, our church has far exceeded our goal of 300 boxes. Let's give God thanks for that. That's more than we brought in, I think, since COVID. So I'm so excited we have surpassed our goal. That is one way our church keeps an outward focus. Drive-thru Nativity is another example. We had a couple of dozen volunteers yesterday that was out there helping us to construct those sets and to get ready. And as I said earlier, it takes so many people for our church to put on this event that for many people, we hear year after year the same people come through and they say, it's not Christmas till we come through your drive-thru nativity. We have people that come from towards Atlanta, people that come from out past Aiken, South Carolina, people come from hours away to go through our drive-thru nativity. It's a blessing to our community. It helps us to share the good news of Jesus with people that are hungry and thirsty to hear that story. Upward Basketball, we'll be starting practices and games here in January, and it takes coaches and assistant coaches and referees and people to do the devotionals at game day and to donate things and help with the awards night, and it takes prayer warriors. It takes a lot of people to help us reach boys and girls in this community through something as simple as a basketball. And Ben told me the other day that we are like at a record. We have 150-something kids signed up for Upward Basketball. We need coaches and assistant coaches and referees. That's a way that our church focuses out on others. VBS is another way we do this. We reach hundreds of kids through Vacation Bible School, teaching them the truth of God's Word, seeing children come to faith in Jesus, changing families for eternity. And it takes teachers and shepherds and people to help feed and lead games and crafts and music. It takes people to help register these kids and get them where they need to go. It takes a lot of us to make Vacation Bible School happen, but it's worth it. Because there are children who know now their destiny is in heaven. They've passed through the waters of the baptistry because of Vacation Bible School. It's a wonderful, wonderful ministry. We've got a Wild Game Supper coming up again. It's been several years since we've done that. This March, we have a Wild Game Supper. We need meat, first of all. We need some game, so be keeping that in mind. We need cooks. We need people to set up and clean up and do registration and help with follow-up. We have mission trips that we send youth and college students to Gatlinburg. We've got people that go to Honduras every year. And this coming year, I really want our church to put together a West Virginia team. You know, a lot of people I know say, well, I can't do Honduras. I can't go overseas. I can't afford it. I can't, you know, I'm afraid of airplanes, you know, whatever. Listen, West Virginia, we hop in a bus. We're there in a few hours. And we stay at a Christian college up in Bluefield, West Virginia. And it is a wonderful opportunity to feed and to do Vacation Bible School and to do construction. It'd be a great mission trip for families to do together. So please be in prayer with me. I want us to take a good group to West Virginia this summer. And maybe that means you. These mission trips are ways that we as a church focus outward on reaching our neighbors and the nations for Jesus. Christmas presents to foster care children. We're doing that right now in the atrium. Welcome baskets to women who are escaping abuse through safe homes in Augusta. Helping feed and clothe people through manna. Our wheelchair ramp ministry. James was telling me we've got 75 aluminum wheelchair ramps out and around our community right now. Isn't that awesome? 75 homes where you've got people that they're not trapped. They can get in and out because of those ramps. And James and Stephen head up that ministry and do a great job. James said, he said, I thought we'd be doing good if we had 10 ramps. Jesus had better ideas, didn't he? Amen to that. Now, do I think we as a church are doing all that we could possibly do to be outwardly focused? Of course not. There's always room for improvement, but I think we have much to be thankful for. We have much to build on as we continue to be a church of disciple makers who are reaching the generations, reaching our neighbors and the nations for Jesus. But this morning, I want to take just a few minutes and focus on our individual commitments to serve. You know, serving is something that is a tool. Service is a spiritual discipline. It's something, it's a gift from God that helps us overcome this natural drift toward an inward focus, this natural tendency we have to be self-centered. Because we have a choice. We can either be selfish or selfless. We can be self-centered or other-centered. We can be inwardly focused or outwardly focused. We can all be about serve us or service. It's our choice. So I want us to break down Galatians 5:13 specifically and discover how God gives us the grace to serve. And first, Paul points out our calling. Our calling is to spiritual freedom. Paul's addressing believers, us, those who are called to be free. And so when we talk about serving others as Christians, we're not talking about philanthropy. This isn't about getting in your community service hours. We're talking about something that should flow from the Spirit of Christ living within us, that should be a fruit that is produced in our lives because we are staying connected to Jesus. On down in verse 16, Paul calls it living or walking by the Spirit. And he says in verse 16 that if we are walking by the Spirit, we won't carry out the desires of the flesh. And Jesus is our example for this. Jesus laid down His life for us, so we should lay down our lives for each other. Jesus forgave us, so we should forgive each other. Jesus came to serve, not be served, and we should follow His example and seek for ways to serve others. So we don't do this out of some misplaced idea that we've got to earn God's favor. Listen, God's grace is His unmerited favor. He gives that freely. We serve because we've already received God's unmerited favor. We serve out of an abundance of God's grace at work in us. We serve because Jesus served. We love because Jesus loved. We give because Jesus gave. We forgive because Jesus forgave. It's all about Jesus. So when we talk about serving, look, we're not ever trying to put a guilt trip on somebody. We don't want you to serve out of guilt. We don't want you to serve out of some idea that this is something you just got to do. It's your duty. We want you to serve because you want to serve freely out of love. We are called to spiritual freedom. But then Paul gives us the challenge. Our challenge, the challenge that we face, is that we tend toward self-centered desires. He says not to use your freedom as an excuse to indulge your fleshly desires. And that's what we tend to do. Even as recipients of God's saving grace, even as people living in spiritual freedom, we are constantly tempted to turn it all inward toward this self-centered entitlement, to use our spiritual freedom to indulge our fleshly desires. And we live in a culture that encourages this, that tells us to obey your thirst, to have it your way, to follow your heart, to be your authentic self. Even in church, we're tempted to want to complain when things don't go our way. I know that never happens, right? We never do that. Or we tend to evaluate worship based on how it made me feel, whether I liked it. Did the preacher's sermon feed me today? We mistakenly think that our time, money, and resources are our own to do with however we please. And we become so busy and consumed with acquiring things that we don't have the time, money, or energy to give very much to God. For many people, they can't even give Him a couple of hours out of the weekend to worship, much less hours during the week to serve others. I mean, our lives have so little margin. How can we possibly give and do more to be on mission for God? How could I ever stop to help someone in need when I've got so many important things to do? I've got schedules to keep. I've got places to go. Certainly some other good Samaritan will step in and do it, right? We tend toward these self-centered desires. That's the challenge. But then Paul gives us the solution. And that is to serve others out of love. The only way we can overcome that tendency toward an inward focus, a self-centered focus, the only solution is to make ourselves, to develop the spiritual discipline of serving others out of love. And Paul gives us three reasons between this and the passage we'll look at in a minute in Philippians chapter 2. Three reasons why serving others is the solution. First, service brings freedom. It brings freedom. When we adopt an attitude and lifestyle of service, listen, that becomes a great filter that can help us prioritize our lives, right? To help us simplify and slow down and build some margin into our lives. When we focus on a life of service, it frees you to be able to say no. How many of y'all have a hard time saying no? And often what happens is we end up saying yes to good things that then make us say no to great things. But when you have a life that's oriented towards serving others in love, it acts as a filter that really helps you to say no to those mediocre things, to those things that, yeah, they're good, but they're not the best for us. They're not the greatest things that we can do with our time. Service frees us from that, and service frees us from the world's idea of greatness, which brings us to the second thing service brings, and that's humility. You may remember Jesus' disciples were arguing over who would be the greatest in the kingdom of God. And he answered in Matthew 20. He said, "You know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them." Right? They throw their weight around. You know, they make a big deal of, you know, "I'm in charge," that sort of thing. He says, "Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your" what? Servant. Service frees us from the world's ideas of power and greatness and authority. Because Jesus' authority here, he says, your authority and power is not found in a title, it's found in a towel. It's found in washing one another's feet. It's found in being a servant, not waiting to be served. It's not about who serves you, it's about who you are serving. Service brings humility. It brings freedom. And finally, it brings joy. Oh, I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's talk about humility a little bit more. There's a quote that I was going to give. So on Wednesday nights, we've been walking through the Bible, right? And the past couple of Wednesdays have been in Kings, been in Chronicles. And those of you that have been there, we talked about how even the good kings of Judah, and there were a few good kings in Judah, even they, at the end of their life, seemed to be tripped up by pride. Pride even brought them down, which is an example for us that even when we're doing good things, even when we're trying to be service-oriented, if we're not careful, we can become prideful. And we can start wanting that applause, that recognition, that pat on the back. We can start saying, "Hey, I've done this and I've done that. You know, something ought to be coming toward me." And for all of those kings, that was their downfall. Serving others as a discipline out of love is a way that we can resist that, and we can nurture this humility, which we said Wednesday night, that being humble is two things. It's keeping yourself in your right position with God. God's up here, I'm down here, right? All right, I'm not God, He is. But it's also looking at ourselves through God's eyes. So being humble isn't about berating yourself and tearing yourself down. It's about seeing yourself properly as God sees you. Richard Foster writes this: "Of all the classical spiritual disciplines, service is the most conducive to the growth of humility. Nothing disciplines the inordinate desires of the flesh like service, and nothing transforms the desires of the flesh like serving in hiddenness." Service brings humility. And finally, service brings joy. Because serving others, I think, is one of the best ways to remember that our lives are all about grace. True service is going to flow from our relationship with God, not self-righteous efforts. It's about relationships, not about rewards and results. It's about inward joy, not outward accolades. And when we're focused on giving, doing for others out of love, what we find is that as we pour God's grace into other people's lives, it simply makes room in our heart to receive more grace from God. As we bless others and we give to others, He blesses us, He gives to us. That's how we truly become that channel, that vessel of God's blessing to flow into the lives of other people. I have found that it's genuinely hard to serve out of love and not experience joy and gratitude. And that's why I encourage parents to get your kids involved in service opportunities. Let them go on a mission trip. Take them on a mission trip, because it's such a great way to help them develop this genuine sense of gratitude for all the blessings they have and to learn how to focus on other people, not themselves. In Philippians chapter 2, Paul writes about this joy. In fact, in this short book of Philippians, Paul mentions joy 14 times. And he says here in Philippians 2, 1 through 5, he says, "If then there is any encouragement in Christ, if any consolation of love, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any affection and mercy, make my joy complete by thinking the same way, having the same love, united in spirit, intent on one purpose. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility consider others as more important than yourselves. Everyone should look not to his own interests, but rather to the interests of others." And he tells us that when we do this, we are adopting the same attitude as that of Christ Jesus. Amen. Paul says the key to joy is humble, selfless service. And notice here that connection with humility, that connection with freedom. Because we're free, we are to serve. And as we serve, we experience more freedom. And as we serve, we grow in our humility. We experience great joy and gratitude. You know, what if you made a commitment to put others before yourself? What if every morning you prayed, "Lord Jesus, as it would please you, send somebody to me today that I can serve"? What if that's our prayer every day? What if we could dedicate 2 hours a week to serving other people? That could be here through the church, you know, helping with the nursery or children's church or upward basketball or doing something with your Sunday school class. It could be visiting one of our homebound members, writing cards of encouragement to people you've not seen in a while. It could be going out into our community and volunteering and serving in some of these great organizations we have, packing bags at Manna, being a mentor and reading to kids at one of our schools. Be creative. Maybe God is laying some need on your heart. Maybe He wants you to begin a new ministry in and through our church. I would love to hear about it and how we as a church can come around you and help you engage in that ministry. Get people involved. Imagine the difference it could make in your Sunday school class, in your family, in our church, if we truly understood the grace to serve that God gives us every day. You know, the word that we translate deacon is the Greek word diakonos, and it means a servant. That's the Greek word for serve. What we've been talking about all morning, it's that Greek word deacon. And so the deacons stand as examples for us of this grace of service. They show us that in God's grace, any of us can serve. They model for us what it means to put other people before themselves, to understand what it means to be a member, a part of the whole body of Christ. Through the affirmations of this church family, God has called three men to the office of deacon. And we come now to a time for ordaining them into this ministry. We're also going to affirm and install 8 men to a 3-year term of active service and commission all 24 of next year's deacons for the work in the coming year. Mr. Keith Beggs, Keith and Candy, he begins his service immediately. Keith is fulfilling the uncompleted term of Mr. Garrett Edmonds. And Keith and Candy are longtime members of First Baptist Church. Keith, you can go ahead and stay standing there for a few minutes. It's okay. He is like I said, a longstanding member of our church, very active, both of them in our children's ministry, as you heard already this morning, and they both help in the events that we hold here, like our fall festival recently and our spring extravaganza to help reach children in our communities. But I think one of the greatest avenues of ministry for Keith is working through the Beggs Funeral Home, as he helps families, graciously, compassionately helps families walk through some of the most difficult decisions and times of their lives. This morning, I think it's a neat experience that Keith is following in his son's footsteps in becoming a deacon. Chase was ordained a few years ago, and he's been serving as a deacon here. And I think it's especially neat that on his ordination certificate, since Chase is the secretary of the deacons this year, he got to sign his dad's own ordination certificate. Isn't that neat? I think that is so cool. Now, sort of the reverse of that, we have Drew and Courtney, Mr. Drew Poston and Courtney. Drew is following in his dad's footsteps, of course, Mr. Jay Poston, and his granddad's footsteps, Mr. Jimmy Poston. That makes Drew the third generation of his family to serve as a deacon here at First Baptist Thomson. I've known Drew most of his life. I've watched him grow up here, and I'm so proud of the opportunity I have now to be able to be a part of ordaining him into this ministry of being a deacon. Drew has served this church in several ways. He is a part of our Go and Tell team and has been instrumental in planning some of these events that we have offered our community. He's a vital member of the Honduras mission team and has been a part of that for many, many, many years. He also is leading our plans for the Wild Game Supper coming up this March. And Mr. Stephen Palmer and his wife, Betty Sue, now they joined our church family recently in 2020. And as Stephen was coming from a Presbyterian background, I had the honor and privilege of baptizing him into the membership of this church and now get to be a part of his ordination as a deacon. Stephen has served our church in many ways, and the few years they've been here so far, he's the teacher for the men's outreach class. He's worked with James Bridges on our wheelchair ramp ministry, and he's also served on the Go and Tell committee. So both Drew and Keith and also Stephen have been a part of a lot of our community outreach events to reach children and families in our community. Stephen is also a Gideon, and he and his wife serve as volunteers with the local Red Cross. So if y'all would please turn and face me. Keith Beggs, Stephen Palmer, and Drew Poston. You have been called of God and selected by this New Testament church to serve our Lord and this church in the New Testament office of deacon. You must answer this call with full understanding of the biblical purpose and qualifications of a deacon and the commitment to our church's deacon ministry. I'm going to ask you a series of questions at the end of which you will voice your commitment to this office. Will you accept this responsibility and strive to fill the position to which you were called in protecting the fellowship and the unity of this church, in assisting the pastors whenever you can do so, and in looking out for the needs of the congregation? Will you affirm your allegiance to Christ, the church, and His holy word? Will you accept the office of deacon and promise faithfully to perform the duties required of this office? Will you promise to cooperate with the pastors, staff, and leaders to help the church to fulfill its purpose of loving God, loving people, and making disciples of Jesus from all generations, and in promoting the harmonious and effective working of all of its ministries? If you so accept, affirm, and promise, would you answer with, "I will, with God as my helper"?
I will.
Amen. Will you, the members of First Baptist Church in Thomson, Georgia, acknowledge and affirm these brothers as being called of God as New Testament deacons? Will you esteem, encourage, pray for, and cooperate with them as they perform the duties of a deacon? If so, would you answer, "We will, with God as our helper"? We will, with God as our helper. Amen. I now charge you, Keith, Stephen, and Drew, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, to ever strive to fulfill your office to the best of your knowledge and to seek the guidance and strength of the Spirit of God in all the work that you do. Would you please be seated and have your wives come and stand behind you? And I want to say a word to Candy and to Betty Sue and to Courtney. Your support and encouragement to your husbands is vital to their ministry. You will be a big part of their role as a deacon and supporting their work and being that example with them of service to this church family. As members of First Baptist Church and members of these families, I'm going to invite you now to come around and to place hands on these men and speak a brief word of blessing, encouragement, of prayer to them. And we're going to come this way as we come around and do this. There's a basket over here. If you have a card you want to give these men, drop it in that basket and we will get it to them. And as you finish this, you can return to your seats, and I will lead the way in this.
these men.
Before I pray, I'm going to share one thing. I think today, of course, is special to me. I get to see three men that I truly love, that I truly admire, become ordained, but especially get the privilege of seeing my son be ordained. And that's you know, it hits pretty deep. And son, I'm proud of you. And I just want to say that publicly. But I want to reiterate something that Mr. J. Mixon said earlier, bringing your children and being with your children here at church. And I just want to thank so much our young parents for having their children here. Seeing the thunder and herd come down every Sunday morning is such a privilege to be a part of. So with Drew, you know, it's a privilege to be here and to be part of this, but it's also a responsibility that I got to enjoy of sitting in the pew with him. He got multiple spankings back here in the in the bathroom. I mean, let's be truthful about it. And you know, thank you for being here. We made a connection last night. We have five, between the current deacons and the incoming deacons, we have five father-son combinations and three son and father-in-law combinations. And it just shows that Proverbs 22:6 is correct. You start off a child in the way that they should go, and when they're old, they will stay on that path. And so thank you so much for being here. Thank you for being part of this. And I know with children sitting in the pew, this can become a long service. And I just thank you for being part of it. And please know that y'all are doing a good job, and we thank you so much for doing that. With that, let's go to God in prayer together. Dear God, I just thank you so much for these three men. I thank you for the commitment that they have to our church, the leadership that they give us, but more deeply the commitment that they've made to you and to follow wherever you send them, whatever you call them to do. I thank you for their wives. I thank you for their partners that they have there, that they can support each other and love each other and be with each other in the good times and the bad times, but to really go through life hand in hand together. I thank you for the deacons of this church. Thank you for the commitment that these men and their wives have to serving our church and serving our community. Thank you for our staff. Thank you for the support that they give us, the guidance that they give us. And I thank you so much for this church. Thank you for the commitment that this church has to serving our community, to looking after the children that are here, to know that that's our future and that is the next generation is so important for us. And I just thank you for that. I pray for these men that you will just guide and direct them in all that they do. Help them to know your will. Help them to seek your will. But most importantly, I just pray that you will give them opportunities to truly serve. The power does not come from the title of deacon. The power comes from that towel and from serving. And I just pray that you will help us realize that in all that we do, and not just these men, but all of us. Help us to know that serving is the most important thing that we can do. And in doing that, we're sharing your love, and we're sharing your word, and we're sharing the gospel. Pray that you will just be with us as we go out and leave this place and just share the love that we feel here with all that those are around us, and continue to just bless us in all that we do. In these things we pray in Christ's name. Amen.
And with this towel as a symbol and mantle of your call to service. Y'all may return to your seats, and I would like to ask our incoming deacons, those of you that will begin your service in January, would you please just stand where you are? Those of you that are beginning your service this coming January, and if you don't remember who that is,